In this particular video, I will try to make you understand what IoT is, why is it so important these days, what are the components involved. We'll also see what architectures have been proposed by international bodies. We'll also discuss some open source software initiatives. Let's begin our journey. So let me explain you in simple terms what actually IoT is. Suppose we have got projector in our room. We all know projectors get overheated. So if we also have air condition in the same room, so we lower the temperature to get projector working, but all this has to be done manually by us. Now the idea is, if these objects or things start communicating by themselves without human intervention, life would become easy for us, isn't it? So projector will send message to AC, hey, I am getting hot, do something. AC will respond, chill bro. So when these objects or things start forming their own internet, is called Internet of Things. It's like they are having their own internet for communication purpose. In simple word, giving the power of internet to a device, it becomes a smart device. Then we can keep on adding devices. So let me show you the formal definition. So here it is mentioned that the Internet of Things is defined as the network of the physical objects that can be devices, vehicles, buildings and other items, which has got embedded with electronics, software, sensors and network connectivity that enable this object to collect and exchange the data. This is the formal definition. Hope things are clear. So various smart devices are actually available in the market. This is smart clock. If you set the alarm in this particular clock and also set the like train timings which you have to catch or flight timings you have to catch, and this particular clock is totally synchronized with the flight timings or you say train timing. So if the flights get delay, so this particular clock will change your alarm timings accordingly. We have got also this thing, what we call is like glowing handle umbrella. This particular device is synced with the weather forecasting. If it is about to rain, that particular handle will start glowing, and when you're leaving the home, it will show you the like hint that there is a going to rain, so you better carry me with you. Then you all know the smart shoes, which will measure the calories and the distance. We also have got smart watches people are aware of. And this is like something what we call a medicine bottle, having this beep sensor. The timing is totally synchronized. So at particular time, it starts beeping to make you remind like you have to take the medicine. So all these particular devices are the smart devices, are the IoT things, like IoT products, which are available in the market. So basically, various dimension we have got. So as you all see in this particular diagram, that is nothing but a scope of the Internet of Things. So anytime, any place or anything we can connect. So a global infrastructure you set for the information society, enabling the advanced services by interconnecting things based on existing and evolving interoperable information for the communication technologies. So basically it can be between computers, human to human, human to thing to thing, night or daytime, or on the move, you're moving. So this particular devices can be anywhere, any place, anytime it can be available, and it can be anything. You just imagine what you can make. A simple definition has been proposed into the formula form that this physical objects plus controller sensors and actuators and plus internet connectivity, that makes the IoT. See, it contains the microcontroller that provides intelligence. It also contains certain sensors that measure some physical parameter, or you say actuators that acts on the some physical parameter, and it also provides you means of communicating via the internet or some other networks. So when we combine all these things and or we put all this thing into one thing, that becomes IoT, that is Internet of Thing. Nowadays IoT has required in every sector, whether it is healthcare, agriculture or any big or medium sized firm. Because of its security features and cost effectiveness, it becomes a need for every growing business and also gaining importance in our daily lives. Let me just give you the more example in which other service sectors the IoT is really in demand. Like in public sectors, like in IT and networks they need, for security, public safety they need, retail industry they need, transportation, industrial, healthcare, consumer, energy, buildings, all this particular sector they need IoT products nowadays. Many of the use cases could be fulfilled and often are by general purpose computers. You all know, like you can carry the smartphone and the smartphone also can measure the calorie if you are jogging, and it can also measure the distance you cover. But although we don't carry a desktop PC around with us, many of we do carry laptop or tablet, but understand we that other devices to perform dedicated tasks. We also have other, we should have this dedicatedly device to do their dedicated tasks. Smartphone has been built for various other things, but the phone is having the dedicated working is nothing but calling, for the calling purpose. We cannot have the smartphone all the time, so we need other devices to do the dedicated tasks. Like for example, our shoes measure the number of steps instead of our smartphone. Fine, so that's why we are calling it things. So just look at this particular slide. You can pause the video for a while and you can just go through the figure that this many devices are actually exist in the world. Okay, and out of all this, let me tell you, only 1% of the things around us is connected. Means your refrigerator is not connected, your washing machine, microwave oven, mixer grinder, television is got connected. But let me tell you, like all the things which exist in the world, in this world, so it is still not connected to the internet. So we are aiming, the various companies are aiming to make all these things smarter now by putting some sensors, actuators and internet connectivity into them. Accordingly to the Gartner survey, there will be over 26 billion connected devices, IoT devices, in the world by 2020. Consumers will not be the only ones using the IoT devices. Cities and companies are always trying to become more efficient and save both time and money by adapting smart technologies. So there is a huge demand, there will be a huge demand in the market for the IoT devices and IoT jobs. But also, so looking at the market, the Cisco company, IBM and Microsoft, they also started their own venture of Internet of Things. I've just mentioned the banner here that this is their venture, a separate company in the whole company thing. That is, Cisco has started Internet of Everything, company name is, and IBM started a Smarter Planet, and Microsoft has started the Industrial Internet. So all these companies have started their own venture, looking at the importance of this. So components of IoT-enabled things, what are they? First is sensors. A sensor measures some parameter of physical, chemical, biological entity and delivers an electronic signal proportional to the observed characteristics. If you all know, it sends something and it transfers that particular information to digital form. Either in the form of analog, it can be also happen, or digital. So this is the sensor. This is a simple block diagram to make you understand that sensor can measure mechanical, optical, thermal, magnetic position or electrical, biological measurement, and it can then again transfer it to the particular device to monitor and then analyze and plan and then execute. And accordingly, we also have the opposite of sensor, that is actuator, which actually gives you the action in return, the output. That is, sensor takes the input, actuators gives you the output. There are various types of sensors, like positioning, proximity motion, inertial devices, pressure, optical devices, image, camera, magnetic devices, media devices, temperature, specialized, etc. This sensor actually measure with the precision, accuracy and resolution. So there are two key concepts need to be distinguished in discussing sensor, that is precision and accuracy. So as you all can see, you can relate the graph, it's very simple to understand that there is a high precision and the high accuracy means you will get all the input in the like bullseye. But sometimes it can also happen like high precision you're getting, but you are getting the low accuracy, means you are expecting this, but you are getting off the mark. Similarly, we also have got low precision, the high accuracy, that is the, you can see the samples are scattered. Similarly, this is the worst case scenario where the low precision, the low accuracy. So we also have to measure the sensors accordingly before get it into working. Then we have got actuator. Then actuator is nothing but receives an electronic signal from the controller and responds by interacting with its environment to produce an effect on some parameter of a physical, chemical or biological entity. Okay, and actuators also have got type, it can be like hydraulic, pneumatic, electric, mechanical and etc. Then we have got embedded system. You all know embedded system, we have studied this and we have heard this particular term many a times. The term embedded system refers to the use of electronics and software within a product that has a specific functions or a set of functions. Again, this is not a general purpose computer such as laptop or desktop system. Your refrigerator is nothing but an embedded device. Your television, smart television, is nothing but an embedded device. Your smartphone is again an embedded system. Okay. Then we have got a microprocessor, So microprocessor is nothing but like it has got the chips included with the registers, and also have got ALU, that is arithmetic logic unit, and some sort of control unit or instruction processing logic. Then we have got microcontroller. A microcontroller chips makes a substantially different use of logic space available. So microcontroller has got the microprocessor and other things. You can just have a look in this particular diagram. It has got digital to analog, analog to digital converter, then RAM, ROM and EEPROM, and etc. Then they have got transceiver. That is, a transceiver contains the electronics needed to transmit and receive the data. So most of the IoT device contain wireless transceiver capable of communication using like Wi-Fi or ZigBee or some other wireless scheme. RFID is very important. That is radio frequency identification. It's nothing but a technology which uses the radio waves to identify the items. Like what particular thing is communicating to what particular things, what particular entity is messaging. So it is increasingly becoming an enabling technology for the IoT. The main elements of RFID is systems and tags. So basically this is the RFID tag and reader you all see here. So they come in variety of shape, size and functionality and cost. But of course, an RFID readers acquires this is the RFID reader acquire and sometimes rewrite the information stored by the on the RFID tags and all. So this is how things, these are the actually component which get used in the IoT. Two architecture have been proposed by two international bodies. The first is ITUT IoT reference model. That is International Telecommunication Union, the organization name is. So that particular figure depicts the reference model which consists of four layers as well as management capability and security capabilities you all can see. So let me discuss one by one what this layer act as. So in terms of communication functionality, the device layer includes roughly the OSI physical and data link layers. Then we have got network layer that performs two basic functions, that is networking capability refer to the interconnection devices and gateways, and also transport capability refer to the transport of IoT devices and application specific information. Then we have got services support and application support layer, which provides capabilities that are used by applications, generic support you can say, that can be used by many different applications you see. Then we have got application layer that consists of all the applications that can interact with the IoT devices. We also have got management capability layers, which is responsible for doing device management, local network topology management, traffic and congestion management. I'm not getting into deep here, I'm just giving you the introduction. And one more important functionality, that is security capability layer, which handles the application, network and device, which handle the security like facility to all, gives a facility to all this application, network and device layer. One more model we have got, that is ITUT IoT reference model. Sorry, actually this model is named as IoT World Forum reference model. Okay, so I've just mistaken here. You can see the name here mentioned, that this particular model is nothing but IoT World Forum reference model. The previous one was ITUT IoT reference model, and this one is IoT World Forum reference model. Here also they have got the concept of layer. So let me discuss one by one. The first is physical devices and controllers level. As with the ITUT model, the elements at this level are not physical things, but rather devices that interact with the physical things. Then we have got connectivity level. Like from a logical point of view, this level enables the communication between devices and communication between devices and the low level processing that occurs at level number 3. This is something really interesting, that is edge computing, that is also known as fog computing. In many IoT deployments, massive amounts of data may be generated by distributed network of sensors. So for example, like offshore somewhere like oil fields and refineries and can generate a terabyte of data per day. An airplane can create multiple terabytes of data per hour. rather than store all of that data in central storage accessible to the IoT application, it is often desirable to do as much data processing close to the sensor as possible. Thus, the purpose of edge computing level is to convert the network data flows into information that is suitable for the storage. So we don't want to send the data in bulk, we just want to send the information. So we put some filter there to process the whole data, to pull out some information. So this processing element at this level may deal with the high volumes of data and perform data transformation operation, resulting in the storage of much lower volumes of data. That's what we call fog computing. Next, we have got data accumulation. In data accumulation, data coming from numerous devices and filtered and processed by edge computing level is placed in the storage that will be accessible by the higher levels. Data abstraction. In this level, it absorbs large quantity of data and places them in storage with little or no tailoring to specific applications. Then we have got application level. That this level contains any type of application that uses IoT input or controls IoT devices. Generally, the application interact with the level number 5 and data at rest, and so do not have to operate at network speeds. And the last layer is collaboration and the process level. This level recognizes the fact that people must be able to communicate and collaborate to make an IoT useful. Fine, so this is again one more model has been proposed by IoT World Forum. Okay, so this were the two architecture. Now let's discuss which is the last part of this video, that is open source software initiative, IoTivity. IoTivity is an open source software initiative. Their objective is to provide a standard and open source implementation, so devices and services will be able to work together regardless of who makes them. Two organizations are playing a key role in the IoTivity project. The project is sponsored by the Open Interconnect Consortium, OIC. OIC is nothing but an industry consortium whose purpose is to promote an open source implementation to improve the interoperability between the billions of devices making up the IoT. OIC is working on developing standards and overall framework. The IoTivity project is hosted by the Linux Foundation, the non-profit consortium dedicated to fostering the growth of Linux and collaborative development. Finally, the last part, that is IoT implementation. The first is Cisco IoT system. Here we have got one diagram, a very simple way to understand. We have got, you can see like there are six pillars. So in 2015, Cisco actually introduced a suite of integrated and coordinated products known as Cisco IoT system. The philosophy guiding product development is based on the following observation, that Cisco estimates that 50 billion devices and objects will be connected to the internet by 2020. Yet today, more than 99% of things in the physical world will remain unconnected. So to capitalize on the unprecedented opportunities presented by this wave of digitization, companies and cities are increasingly deploying the IoT solutions. So we have got here, you can see all the devices lies here, and then we can have the fog computing for filtering all the data to send the information towards the cloud or the applications. So in that, the first pillar is network connectivity, that includes the purpose built routing, switching and wireless products available. Then we have got fog computing, which is responsible to provide edge data processing platform. Then we have got data analytics, which is an optimized infrastructure to implement analytics and harness actionable data for both. Then we have got security, cyber and physical. This particular pillar unifies the cyber and physical security to deliver the operational benefits and increase the protection on both physical and digital assets. Then we have got management and automation. These are the tools for managing the endpoints and application. And the last one is application enable platform, a set of APIs for industry and cities ecosystems, partners and third party vendors, which people can use to design, develop and deploy their own applications. So these are the, you can say features are available in the market. IoBridge is nothing but provide you the software, firmware and web services designed to make it simple and make it simple, cost effective also. to internet enabled devices and product for the manufacturer. So we have got one diagram here. You can see they have given you the module. So by providing all the components necessary to web enable things, iOBridge customers avoid the complexity and cost associated with piecing together solution from the multiple vendors. So whenever we build IoT devices, we get concerned about various functionality. So this iOBridge is actually giving you all the related or required modules easily available. So like it is bridging the gap. Okay, so the iOBridge is offering you the essentially a turnkey solution for a broad range of IoT users. So this is a summary of this particular video. We understood the concept of IoT, we saw the formal definition also, we also understood the like what demand is going on, which will be like very huge, what are the components are available, and we also saw two architectures and how it will be getting implemented and what open source initiatives and open source, you can say like standard platforms are available. They are actually helping us to build the IoT devices. So thank you guys. I hope you enjoyed this video. Concepts are clear and I'm so sure you must have got complete idea of IoT. If you like it, please press on like button and subscribe to my channel. This is the reference I have used. Thank you so much.